Well, hey, hey, Harvest! Man, it is so good to worship Jesus Christ together as a church family, and now we're going to be turning our attention to God's Word today, and this is the third week of our series, Just Jesus, Come and See. Come and See. So we're going to be in Mark chapter 1, if you want to go ahead and head there. Mark chapter 1. You know, as I was getting ready for what I was going to talk about today, I was thinking about the fact that I currently don't have to ever worry about how to get from point A to B in my car anymore because my phone now does that for me, which is pretty awesome that we just have these things in our pocket that tell us where to go, you know, take a left, take a right. If you were born after 1995, some of the things I'm about to talk about are going to be foreign to you, and the Lord still loves you. It's okay. But before there was the GPS in your phone, there was actually a GPS device by itself. And some of these are still around, and it would be, you'd put it on your windshield, and it would only do one thing, and that was to give you directions. But then before that, there was this thing called MapQuest. So here's what MapQuest is. We got to explain it to these people. You would actually print out the steps of directions of how to get from point A to point B. And maybe you don't even know what printing is. I can't help you if you don't know what that is. Like, you're just too far gone. But I used to have to print directions. And then when I went from MapQuest to a GPS, I remember thinking, man, this is way better. Like, this is so much better. And then when I went from GPS to my iPhone 3G was the first one I got, and I was like, this is way better. And I started using Apple Maps, which is the app on the phone that you use for directions. And you should just know the Hoagland family, we are a Apple family in general. I just feel like the Lord's called me to defend my children from anything Windows operating system. You know, anything PC, I protect them. That's my role as their father. And we have a lot of Apple devices in our house. And I use Apple Maps, but hear me when I say it's not perfect. Apple Maps has taken me to places, not to the wrong place, but it's taken me to places that just don't exist. Like, I'm just like, this is just an open field. This is not where I'm trying to get to. And so I have some friends who use Google Maps, a different app. And, oh, look, there's a lot of support for it. and they tried to get me to switch, and I was just like, oh, but the interface is so different, and the voice giving me directions is a little bit more aggressive, and I don't really appreciate its tone. And so I mostly stay with Apple Maps. And but then last year, we were in Los Angeles in the summer. I was finishing up my master's. I'm there with my family. And Los Angeles is, like, pro-level terrible traffic. You think we got it bad here, like, they take it to a whole other place. Like, there's nothing like being on the 401 at 5 o'clock during rush hour. It's just awful. It really is just awful. And I had to do that every day while I was there, sitting in that traffic. And then I remembered that a friend told me about a different app called Waze. And Waze, W-A-Z-E, is an app that's pretty different because it not only gives you data, it gives you directions, but you're actually sending data to it, and then it's sharing that with the rest of the world. So for example, if you're in traffic, it's actually reading how fast you're in traffic, so it'll be like traffic at 10 miles an hour, traffic at 2 miles an hour. And then people can actually report things like, oh, there's a pothole there, and someone could pop their tire on that, so I'm going to report it. And then when I come along the same road, it tells me, pothole, report it ahead. And it's a pretty amazing thing. But the other thing that it does is it offers you alternate routes. So if you're sitting in traffic, it'll be like, hey, maybe you can go this way and just through these people's neighborhood instead of being on the interstate. And you might save like 5 minutes. But hey, 5 minutes, when you're sitting in traffic for an hour, 45 minutes to go 20 miles, 5 minutes is pretty awesome. Because at least you're moving. And so sometimes you'll be zigzagging around. But I didn't know that Waze was better for what I needed because I just didn't know it existed until someone told me about it. And then once I knew about it and I tried it, then I realized that it was better than what I had. And I didn't realize that there was a better way of using my phone for directions. And many of us don't know that there is a better way of doing what God has called you to do. There's a better way of doing it. Because you are a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not just the pastors, not just the people on staff. Sadly, in Western culture, we use that word minister to try to look at people who work at the church, where it's their job, and we call those people ministers. But I actually think the scripture says something different about ministers. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 through 10 says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. I love that. You know, we used to not be a people, us, like the people in this room. We used to not be a people, but now we are a people and we are God's people. What we have in common is that we are God's people. And once you didn't receive mercy, once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And even more, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12 says it this way, and he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds and teachers to do what? To do the work of ministry? No, that's not actually what the Bible teaches. He establishes those leaders to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ, to equip the saints. Saints is not some like upper level of Christian. Saints refers to every believer, the people that God has made holy. That's you and that's me. And we are the ones who are to do the work of ministry. And that is why I'm saying to you that you are a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Every single one of you is a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But just because you're a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ doesn't mean you're doing it the best way possible. Because there's different ways of doing the thing that God has called you to do. And maybe you walked in here today and you are tired. And I don't just mean like yesterday was a long day. I mean, you know something's not right with the way that you're going about being a minister for Jesus Christ. But the good news I have for you today is that there's a better way. There's a better way of doing ministry. And we're going to focus on Jesus and just Jesus, and we're going to come to him, and we're going to learn from him a better way of doing ministry. That's what I want to talk to you about today, a better way of doing ministry. Now, I could have just as easily picked the word best, right, for my title. It could be the best way of doing ministry. If it's the way Jesus did it, of course it's the best, but I chose the word better because I want you to have in your mind that we're comparing it to ours, that Jesus' way is better than your way, that Jesus' way is better than my way of doing ministry. So we're going to dive into God's word together, but first, let's just take a moment and pray. Father, we come before you expectant of what you're going to teach us. For there are some of us that we just feel like we're at the end, and we want to give up. And the reason we want to give up is because we have not found that there's a better way to do the thing you've called us to do. So God, would you teach us as we open your word? We know we're going to hear from you, but we're saying we want to listen. We want to be open to what you have for us. And it's in the name of Jesus that we commit this time to you. In his name we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. All right, Mark chapter 1 is where we're diving in. On this third week of the series, let me just recap for us real quick what's happened. So at the beginning of chapter 1, we see John the Baptist, and he is preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And John was baptizing most likely on the southern part of the Jordan River. And so it's right before it pours into the Dead Sea. That's probably the area where he's baptizing. Then Jesus shows up and he's baptized. And then the Spirit drives Jesus out to the wilderness, to the Judean wilderness, which is to the west of where he gets baptized. And then after that, Jesus heads up north to Galilee. And when he heads up north to Galilee, he's going across that western coast of the Sea of Galilee, and he calls his first disciples. He calls Andrew and Simon and James and John, and now they drop everything, and they start following him, and then they end up at the town of Capernaum, which is on the northern side of the Sea of Galilee. Then they enter into the synagogue. You remember we talked about this last week with Pastor Dave Stone. He enters the synagogue, and that's where he heals the demon-possessed man. They leave the synagogue, and they head over to Simon's mother-in-law's house for the after party. So they're hanging out there, and then Jesus heals Simon's mother-in-law. And then at sundown, it says that they brought to him all who were sick or oppressed by demons. So sundown, I don't know, probably 7 or 8 o'clock, and that's when they show up. And then Jesus heals all of them. So in the book of Mark, it says that they brought to him all who are sick, and he healed many of them. And that doesn't mean a portion of the all, because in the book of Matthew, in the parallel passage, we know that he healed all of them. So think of it this way. All of them refers to how many of them that were there did he heal? And the answer is all of them, but that could have been 5 people. It could have been 2 people, and it would have been all of them. Mark's showing us the fact that how many is it? It's many. It's a lot, is what Mark's telling us. So if it's a lot of people and he heals all of them, how late do you think he went into that night? I don't know, probably midnight is a pretty safe guess, maybe 1 a.m. I think it's probably somewhere into the late hours of the night. So that is a long day of ministry. And then we get to verse 35 where we're jumping in. And so if Jesus had a long day of ministry, then what I'd expect is for him to go to sleep and just rest up and then get up the next day and be like, all right, now I'm ready to keep going. Because that would have been Eddie's way of doing it, just so you know. I'd be like, all right, I need to rest, I need to recover, and then I can keep doing the work that God's called me to. But Jesus has a different way of doing things. Jesus has a better way of doing ministry. And that's the first thing we see him do here. In verse 35, it says, and rising very early in the morning, while it was still dark, very early in the morning. So the word very is actually very emphatic, meaning rising up super early in the morning, while it was still dark, he departed and went out to a desolate place. The word departed there refers to the fact that he's leaving Simon's mother-in-law's house, and the word went out refers to the fact that he's getting away from people. Okay, so that's why those two phrases are there. And where does he go? He goes to a desolate place, a place just quiet, where there's no one else, where there's no business going on. So a desolate place, probably outside the city limits of Capernaum, and where there's no business, there's no houses. It's just, it's a quiet place where he gets alone, and then he does this. Verse 35 ends saying, and there he prayed. And there he prayed. You want to learn from Jesus a better way of doing ministry? It starts right here. You have to do what Jesus did. And what did he do? He prioritized time alone with God. Jesus prioritized time alone with God. And you have to do that. If you want to find this better way of doing ministry, you have to prioritize time alone with God. Now, have you ever thought about the fact that it's kind of crazy that Jesus prayed? I used to think about the fact, well, hold on a second. Jesus is God. I mean, he's a triune God, so he's praying to the Father, but that's he's the God three in one, so he's kind of praying to himself. And I used to think about that, and I don't pretend to understand the Trinity fully, though I believe it because I see it in Scripture. But even though I don't understand it, all the more reason that this has power. Because if you think about the fact that Jesus, being God, but also being human now, he comes, and in the middle of his busy, in the middle of the work that he's doing, he prays. What else could God do to say louder to us that this is important? What else could God do to say, you need to pay attention to how significant this is? And this is a significant moment in the life of Jesus, in the ministry of Jesus, and we know that because Mark actually only tells us that Jesus prayed three times. He prayed many more times, but Mark's only going to tell us three times, and I think it's because of how significant it is in this passage. He prays here in chapter 1, then the next time he mentions it, it's going to be at the feeding of the 5,000, which is the only miracle recorded in all four of the Gospels, so it's a very significant moment there too, and then the third time is in the Garden of Gethsemane. And those are the only three times that Mark tells us that Jesus prays. So notice the significance of this moment, and Jesus is prioritizing time alone with the Father in prayer. See, here's the thing about prayer. Prayer changes you. Time alone with God changes you. That's actually not that hard to understand when you think about it. You remember that friend you had in high school that you used to hang out every day, and then you guys go to different colleges, then you meet back up years later, and you're like, yeah, you're kind of different now. Like, things have changed. Why have you changed? Well, the reason they've changed is because I got a different set of friends who has a different set of inside jokes, who has a different set of values. All those things change because the people they were spending time with changed them in that way. They influenced them in that way. So how much more, if we spend time with God Almighty in prayer, it's going to change you. If you're spending time with him, it's going to start showing up in the way you talk, the way you behave. All these things that we do, it's going to influence us because prayer changes us. And the problem is not that we don't believe in prayer. That's not the problem. I believe the problem is that we don't prioritize it. It's not that we don't believe in the power. We've seen God do great things, and yet why don't we prioritize it? So let me give you a list of four unacceptable substitutions for prayer. Sorry, five. Five unacceptable substitutions for prayer. Now, let me be very clear. Everything I'm about to say all these five things are awesome things. They're all good things. We need to be doing all five of these things. But notice what I'm saying is that they're unacceptable substitutions for prayer. You can't do all five of these things, and if you're missing out on time alone with God, I'm saying you're missing out. And that might be the reason why you're so tired, is because you're not doing ministry the better way that Jesus did ministry, as he prioritized the fact that he needed time alone with the Father. When I made this list, just so you know, it stung a little bit for me. So you're in good company if, as I read it, it stings a little bit for you. So here's the first unacceptable substitution for prayer. Weekend worship services. We are in it right now, and I love gathering with God's people, and I love worshiping the Lord together, but this is not to replace the fact that God wants to spend time alone with you. You can't come to all the services on any given weekend at any one of our campuses and say, I'm going to double up, I'm going to go to more services. If that's substituting the fact that God wants time with you, you're missing it. Weekend worship services. Second, small group. And maybe you're that person who's been on the fence for years and you're like, I'm not going to get in small group. It's too hard. It's too hard to figure out. And then you finally take the plunge. You join a small group and it's just awesome that you're living in community and you're starting to see that there's mutual ministry between you and your brothers and sisters. And then you're praying for one another and you're encouraging one another. All these things are amazing things and part of the walk that we have with Christ. But it was never meant to replace the fact that God wants time alone with you. And you could be spending time with other believers, but it's never supposed to substitute the priority of prayer. Third thing, giving of the tithes and offerings, right? Why build a relationship with God if I could just send him a check? If I could just support his ministry, wouldn't that make him happy enough? No, you don't understand. God wants your heart. God wants your heart. And when he has your heart, your treasure will reflect that. All those things will come in the right order if God has your heart. And that's why you need to spend time with him. Number four, serving the Lord. Maybe you're that person who just serves and serves and serves, and you have this little magic potion in your backpack. You pull it out on weekends, you drink it, and you become three people, and you're serving in Harvest Kids, on the worship team, and teaching a class over there, all simultaneously somehow, because you're serving, 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 and you're more like Martha, but you got to be like Mary. Mary chose the better thing. Why? Because she spent time with Jesus. And Martha was serving the Lord, but Mary chose the better thing. Mary found the better way of doing ministry. And then lastly, this, number five, seeking godly counsel. I completely believe in this. I want to seek godly counsel for every important decision that comes my way. I ask friends, I have people I respect that I ask them because I know that there's wisdom in the counsel of many. But isn't it pretty backwards that we would jump on that first before going to God himself? It's backwards if we're substituting, hey, here's a big decision, let me go to other people. And God's like, well, what about me? What if you spend time praying with me first and then go to other people? Don't substitute godly counsel with the priority that it needs to be to spend time alone with God. So that's our first point. And then what happens? Verse 36. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. They searched for Jesus. And in the English language, that's just not strong enough. What that means is they hunted him down. All right? And they weren't about to shoot like a bow and arrow at Jesus. They weren't hunting him in that way. But you see the force in it. They're like, where is he? Where is he? They searched for him and they found him and said to him, everyone is looking for you. So it's not just a couple people now. It's not like Simon and his mother-in-law just be like, we found you. No, it's crowds of people now that are searching for him. And the Bible doesn't tell us exactly why they were looking for him, but I don't think it's that hard to figure out within the context of the passage, right? What happened the day before? He was in Capernaum. He heals a guy at the synagogue. He heals all these people that night. And the word starts to spread even within the day, right? He heals a guy in the afternoon, and then by the evening, look at all these people they're bringing. I think it's pretty clear that by the morning, everyone is looking for him because they're looking for the miracle worker. They're looking for that miracle for them too. And everyone's looking for him, and look at what Jesus does, verse 38. And he said to them, let us go on to the next towns that I may preach there also. For that is why I came out. That's why I came out. What is Jesus doing? He's doing the second thing we need to do to find this better way of doing ministry. He's focusing on his mission. And you have to focus on your mission. Jesus is saying that he came out for this reason, to preach. That's what he's saying. And came out referring to the fact that he came out of heaven to earth with a mission. And Jesus' primary mission was to proclaim the kingdom of God. Though he was also a miracle worker, his miracles were gaining him rapid popularity. But here's the thing. Sometimes what's popular can get in the way of the mission God has for you. Sometimes what's popular can actually make it a little bit harder to do the thing that God's called you to do. And so what you need to do is do what Jesus did, and he focused on his mission. Now, that doesn't mean you stop doing everything else. It's like just like when you focus on something with your eyes, it doesn't mean that everything else disappears. It just simply means it's less important, making sure that I'm focusing on what matters most. And Jesus focused on his mission, which was to preach. Our mission is to make disciples. That's what we're supposed to be doing. And we have to be focusing on our mission. And there's other things that we're going to be doing as we serve the Lord. But here's the thing. You can't let that get in the way of your primary mission right now. And that is to make disciples. You know, I think it would be so healthy for our church if every year at New Year's, each one of us individually asked ourselves, did I make disciples this year? Because we might have a long list of things we did. But if we're not making disciples, then what are we doing? We might be following things that are just popular. But, well, everyone says, you're just so good at that. You're just so good at that. And that's why I do more of it. Well, just because it's popular doesn't mean it's your mission. And you need to focus on the mission that God has given you and me. And that is to make disciples. And Jesus focused on his mission. But notice in verse 39, what does he do? And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons. You see, Jesus, what he's doing, it's not that he stopped performing miracles, is that he made sure that at the focus was the preaching, that he had to fulfill his mission. And so we can still do all the things that we're doing as we serve the Lord, but we have to keep in focus our mission to make disciples. So you have to prioritize time alone with God. You have to focus on your mission. And then finally this, you have to reach out with compassion for others. You have to reach out with compassion for others. Look at what Jesus is going to do in the last five verses of this chapter. Verse 40, and the leper came to him. A leper is someone who had leprosy. Leprosy in the time of the Bible referred to many skin diseases, and I think more notably this terrible disease called Hansen's disease. This is just an awful disease. People would have lesions in their skin, and they would end up with nerve damage. And once you have nerve damage, now you got big problems because you could have your hand over an open fire and it could be burning and you not even know it until it's too late. And so this is why people would lose hands, feet, complete limbs. It was a terrible disease. And at the time of Jesus, people looked at lepers like dead people. Like they're already dead, but they're walking. It's the first season of The Walking Dead in the Bible times, you know? And so they're just looking at these people and they're like, oh, this is just terrible. They had to live outside the city. They had to live alone. No one was allowed to approach them. No one was allowed to touch them. And here, this leper comes to Jesus, imploring him, begging him, requesting something of him with great force, and kneeling said to him, he positions himself in humility, and then he does this. He says, if you will, you can make me clean. If you will, you can make me clean. Now notice, as he's requesting something of Jesus, he actually gives a statement. Interestingly enough, it's not a question, it's a statement. And it's a statement of faith. He's acknowledging that Jesus has the power to heal him. He's believing that Jesus can do it if Jesus will, he can heal him. He can make him clean. And what does Jesus do in verse 41? Moved with pity, moved with compassion in his heart. It's another way of saying it. He stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I will be clean. He stretched out his hand and touched him. This is radical. What Jesus does is radical. He, you know, in the Gospels, there's many times where he touches people to heal them. But this is the only time, only with this healing of this leper, are both those phrases used together. That Jesus reached out and that he touched him. Just bringing more emphasis to the fact of how big a deal it is that his heart was filled with compassion that he had to do this. He had to reach out to those who were unreachable. And he had to reach out and touch the untouchable. And maybe you're sitting here today and you think, you know, that's me. Like, if you knew my story and the things that I've done, I'm just too far gone. I've done too many things for God to accept me. And you've been coming to church for a while and you're trying to figure out what's going on and you want to seek God, but you're convincing yourself you're just too far gone. No matter where you're sitting right now, no matter where you're sitting today, I want you to hear me when I say that you're wrong about that. Jesus Christ can reach the unreachable. Jesus Christ can touch the untouchable. And he did that with this man here. And he heals him. He says, I will be clean. Now, like I mentioned, lepers weren't allowed to be touched. So then we got to answer the question, well, what's going on here? If that's what Jesus revealed in the Old Testament law, then what's happening with the fact that he is touching this man, this leper? Well, you have to remember that the purpose of the law is to benefit mankind. And the laws of defilement related to leprosy were designed to protect people from contagion and ritual impurity. But if Jesus touching this man for his benefit, if that's what he's doing, then Jesus is not in formal opposition of the spirit of the law and therefore will not rend himself defiled. Think of it this way. Here's a different way of thinking about it. The leprosy couldn't go from that man to Jesus because the power of God was going from Jesus to that man. Let me say that again. The leprosy couldn't go from that man to Jesus because the power of God himself was going from Jesus to that man. And what Jesus is doing is he's not negating the law. He's not abolishing the law. He's fulfilling the law. That's what he's doing. He's fulfilling the law, bringing it to its prophesied consummation in the kingdom of God. And that is why he can reach out, and that is why he can touch this leper for his benefit and heal him. And then what happens is exactly that, verse 42, and immediately the leprosy left him and he was made clean. The leprosy left him, that's a personification of leprosy, right? It's a disease, and so he says it's like a person that got up and said, I'm out of here. And then it's a different phrase that follows and it says, and he was made clean. And I believe these are different phrases because I think it's telling us that he not only healed him physically, but he healed him spiritually. That this man came in a humble position, made a statement of faith in the power of God, and Jesus with compassion in his heart, he heals his body and he heals his soul. But then what happens? Verse 43, and Jesus sternly charged him and sent him away at once and said to him, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer for your cleansing what Moses commanded for a proof to them. Jesus tells him to go do the thing that he needs to do so that he can, re-enter into society and enjoy the blessing of the miracle that Jesus had done. But it says that Jesus sternly charged him. What does that mean, sternly? Why sternly? Why is Jesus being stern? Well, as you study the word, what that means exactly, it reminded me of when we were growing up, we had this, I was homeschooled in all my elementary school years, and we had this science experiment kit. I'm not exactly sure what it was. It was just a box about this big, and it had a tons of science thing inside, and we would all gather around the living room or around the kitchen table, and my parents would open this up, and there's like chemicals and test tubes, and these test tubes were made out of glass, just so you know. I mean, it was the 90s. I guess they were less safe back then. But like glass test tubes for kids to just be playing with, and who knows what chemicals. I was probably about 6 or 7 when we were doing this, and I remember it. I remember this when we were around the kitchen table, and my dad's like teaching us stuff about chemicals, and these test tubes, they were glass, but they also had this It's like a handle. Sorry, if you're a scientist, I'm just so sorry because I don't know what I'm talking about. But there's a handle, and here's what's crazy about this handle. When you squeeze it, when you press it, then this like circle opens up, and then you put the test tube in the middle, and then when you release it, then it grabs onto the test tube. That is very backwards, just so you know. And it's very backwards for a six-year-old, too. Wait, well, so hold on a second. So if I want to hold on to that thing, I'm supposed to let go of it? And then if I'm supposed to let go of it, I'm supposed to tighten? What? Like, it makes no sense. It's the exact opposite of what you would think it should be. And so we're doing these experiments, and and I look over at my dad, and it's like, finally, Eddie's turn to do something, because I've just been watching. And my older brother and sister, they're doing stuff. And then my dad hands me a test tube filled with some liquid, and he hands it to me, and he looks straight at me, and he's like, Eddie, don't squeeze it. Don't squeeze it. Just grab it lightly and then pour it into the other tube. Don't squeeze it. Don't squeeze it. And he hands it to me and he's, don't squeeze it. Don't squeeze it. And Eddie grabs it. I was always the most nervous of the four kids. And I'm like grabbing it. And I'm like, everyone's screaming things. My dad's saying things. And what do? Obviously. So then I squeeze it. The test tube comes out. It shatters on the floor. The chemical goes everywhere. The floor melts. My brother falls in. I've never seen him since. No, I'm just kidding. It's not that catastrophic, but as my dad, like, I will never forget the face of my dad when he's looking at me and he's just like, don't squeeze it. Don't squeeze it. It's why? And it was pretty stern. Why? Because my dad knew as he was handing it to me, I was probably going to squeeze it. So I think that's what's happening here. Jesus is telling this leper, don't say anything sternly, because he probably knew. This man is going to say something. And what happens in verse 45 is exactly that. Verse 45 says, but he went out and began to talk freely about it and to spread the news so that Jesus could no longer openly enter a town, but was out in the desolate places, and people were coming to him from every quarter. So interestingly enough, because of what this man says, now it's getting in the way of the thing that Jesus was trying to do. Because he can no longer, his popularity is just spreading like wildfire, and he can't even enter into the town openly, so he has to stay outside of the town in the desolate places, but notice the people still find him there, but they're coming to him now. And it was impractical for Jesus to have that happen, but notice it was triggered by his act of compassion. It was triggered by what Jesus did in that man's life that ended up leading to the fact that it became impractical for him. An act of compassion was never meant to be practical. It was meant to be radical. It's not about how easy it is or how convenient it is. It's about showing the grace that you receive towards someone else. Just like you didn't deserve it, they don't have to deserve it either. And your heart should feel compassion for others, and you should reach out with compassion for others. So it just makes me wonder, what opportunities are we missing out on simply because we view it as impractical? And we feel like, man, we should be compassionate towards this person. And then if you're like me, the number one reason why I don't do it is because I've convinced myself in my mind that it's impractical. I tell myself crazy things like, well, if I do that for this person, then I can't do it for everyone. That's not practical. I need to figure out a practical way to help everyone. And this is a tactic of the enemy, I believe. If he can get you to start thinking about, like, well, I can't do this for everyone, then he can get you to stop thinking about the fact that God just wants you to do something for someone. And instead of thinking about everyone, just think about the fact that you have an opportunity to do something for someone. You have an opportunity to show compassion to someone who needs it. And instead of being overwhelmed with all these things that we fill our minds with, what if we just prioritize time with God alone, and then if we're spending time with God, then we can trust that as a door opens, that's what God wants you to do. And instead of putting you before, hey, I have to fix everything that's wrong and everyone who's suffering, I have to feel the weight of all that. Well, no, we all have to do it together, but if each one of us does something, I'm telling you, we're going to be doing a lot. And we're going to be reaching a lot of people with compassion. And I'm not just talking about physical needs. I'm talking about sending that text that you know you need to send to show grace to someone. I'm talking about leaving that voicemail, making that phone call, sending that letter, dropping off that meal, whatever opportunity God is opening up in your heart and you know that would be compassionate, you need to do it because that's God calling you to do something for someone. Don't be overwhelmed by the fact that you can't do everything for everyone. But remember that Jesus reached out with compassion for others. So this is the better way that we find here in God's word. This is the better way of doing ministry. Maybe what you're doing just isn't that great. Maybe what I'm doing is leading me towards the deficiency that I currently sense. And if we were to just come to Jesus and see the way he did ministry, we would find this better way of doing ministry, which is to prioritize time alone with God, to focus on your mission, and to reach out with compassion for others. Now, I'm going to invite the worship team on every campus right now to come up as I close. I want to share this passage from 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13 through 14. And we're going to drive towards doing something. We're going to be doers of God's word as we've learned from Jesus that there's a better way of doing ministry. And 2 Chronicles chapter 7, 13 through 14 says this: "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain," rain is a sign of God's blessing upon us. So when God says, when I shut the heavens and there's no sign of blessing, or command the locusts to devour the land. Now we're talking about loss. Things that we had, the locusts would eat the crop. Things that we had, and then we had lost. "Or send pestilence among my people." Now we're talking about things that affect us. If we don't see signs of God's blessing, and if we have lost things, and if we are now undergoing the pain and the anguish ourselves, notice what God says. He says, "If my people," if, God's going to give you an if-then statement, and he says, "If my people," notice the locusts devour the land, but who's he talking to? My people. "If my people who are called by my name," what did we see in 1 Peter chapter 2? That we were not a people, and now we are God's people. We're God's people because we're called by his name and we're bearing his name. "If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves. Harvest, don't you understand? This is where we belong. This is where we belong. This is where we need to get to. That they would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn away from their wicked ways. If we do those things and say, God, give us eyes to see the ways that we are not honoring you, the ways that we are sinning against you, these wicked ways. And what we're going to do is we're going to humble ourselves in your presence, and we're going to pray, and we're going to seek his face. Not the work of his hands, not the miracles. We're going to seek his face, his character, his attributes, the way that God is, spending time with him. If we do those things, what God says is he will hear from heaven. He will hear us, and he will forgive our sins, and he will heal our land. You want to see healing in your family? You want to see healing in this church? You have to do what God says we need to do, and we have to humble ourselves and pray. And that's why Jesus brought us to this priority of prayer. And I got to tell you, I love all the things we learn in this passage of how Jesus did ministry. But God has been working in my heart about this priority of prayer, because I fear that if we focus on our mission and we show compassion for others, but we're not spending time with God, we've missed it all. We're not going to have the power that we need. We're not going to have the strength that we need to do the thing that God's calling us to do if we're not prioritizing time alone with God. And so I want to challenge every single person at our church. No matter if you're in Crystal Lake, if you're in Elgin, in Aurora, if you're down at the cathedral or at Deerfield Road, or if you're in this room right now, I'm challenging every single person who comes to this church to do what our teacher did, to do what our Lord did. And I want to challenge you to pick a day this week to rise up very early in the morning and pray. And you're going to get to be a doer of this better way. You get to experience this better way of doing ministry. So here's how we're going to do it. I want you each to pick a day. Start with that. Pick a day. It's up to you. This next week, you're going to pick the day. And if you're like, well, I get up every single day and pray, well, that's awesome. Let's just pick one day to do it extra early. All right? Pick a day. I want you to write that down in your notes. This is going to be your guide for this week. Pick a day. Then I want you to pick a place. What kind of place did Jesus pick? He picked a place where he could get alone. So that means no Panera, no Starbucks. We're not doing anything where there's other people. We're going to pick a day and we're going to pick a place where we can get alone. So for me, that's probably going to be my basement, just so you know. That's where I can get alone. So we're going to pick a day, pick a place, then we're going to do this. We're going to get up before the sun comes up. The sun comes up. I already did the research for you. It comes up around 6:45 every day this week. I want you up before 6:45. And even if you're not a morning person, that's okay. Get up before 6:45. And if you normally get up at 6 because that's what you need to do, then you can get up at 5 that one day. And if there, as you're thinking about your day and you're like, oh, well, that's going to be my busy day, probably not that day, I would say, look at the day Jesus did this in. Maybe because it's your busy day, that needs to be the day that you pick. You're going to pick a day, you're going to pick a place, you're going to get up before the sun comes up, then this, you're going to get away from distractions. A desolate place is a quiet place. It's a quiet place because you're not distracted. So I don't want anyone with you. I love praying with my wife, but we're not going to do this together. We're going to get time alone with God, individually. Time alone with God. So nobody with you and no phone. I don't mean silenced phone. I don't mean Bible app on your phone. I really do mean no phone. No phone with you when you're doing this. And no music. Even if you love worship, playing worship music as you spend time with the Lord, that's going to take some of your brain and it's going to focus it on that. I just want it to be a quiet place. We're aiming for a desolate place, a quiet place where nothing's distracting you. And then you're just going to do this. You're going to talk to God. You're just going to talk to God. Don't overthink what I'm calling you to do. Some of you, you've never done this. And God's grace has given you the opportunity to now do this. You've never done this. You've never gotten up early and prayed and talked to God. And you're a little nervous. Well, what if I do all those four things? But then I get there and I'm like, what am I supposed to do, God? What you're supposed to do is talk to him. Just talk to God. Tell him what your day was like. Tell him what happened that day. Tell him what's going to happen the next day, what your plans are looking like. Tell him about the things that are burdening you. Tell him about the things you're excited about. Tell him about the relationship in your life. Tell him everything you can think about. And then be quiet. If you don't have anything else to say, just sit there in quiet. And then keep talking to God. This isn't rocket science. This isn't complex. You just need to talk to God. And the power comes in the prioritization of it. The power is going to come. What do you think God could do if this week our whole church did this? What do you think God would move? What mountain would he just grab that mountain and throw it to the middle of the ocean? If he was sought after the way he needs to be sought after, we don't know what God's going to do. But I know he's going to change us if we spend time with him. I know he's going to change us if we prioritize time alone with him. So as the worship team comes, what they're going to do, they're just going to sing a song over you. And I just want to give you a space to commit this to God. So you're welcome. If you want to kneel before God, you're welcome to kneel. If you just want to sit down and pray, you're welcome to do that. If you want to stand up and raise your hands and worship the Lord, you can do that as well. This is a safe place to worship God. This is a free place to worship God. But now is the time I want each and every one of us to commit this to the Lord.